Hello everyone, I'm Sushmita Sarkar, Assistant Professor, Triple A Department, Army College of Engineering. I welcome you all for my lecture 3 in Module 2, Electric Power Quality. Fine, so in today's lecture, we are going to see more about fundamental principle of protection. You know, last class we have learned how to estimate the voltage sag and before that sources of sag and interruption. So in this particular lecture, we are going to see that how to protect the system, the healthier part of the system from these voltage sag and interruption. Fine, so to start with, let us see what are the learning objectives. So what we are going to learn, we are going to see exactly what are the approaches for voltage sag right through. You know, what does it mean? That means you will be able to understand exactly from where the protection should start, which will sound economical and optimal. Fine, so we have a certain, right through capability curve for individual equipment. So we will just see that at which point, if we set this right through, then the system will sound more economical and give you more optimal solution. Next, we are going to see about the different alternatives as the cost effective, which are cost effective. What are the alternative solutions which are cost effective, basically? Then I'm going to take one simple case study, which will help you to understand what we will talk about in the previous two topics. That is your first two topics, basically. With the help of case studies, we are going to prove that whatever we have understood so far is correct or not. Fine, then we are going to see the last one as what are the solutions? Fine, what are the solutions at the end user level for to prevent the system from voltage sag and interruption? Fine, so as we know that the voltage sag is really a very important issue, especially at the utility end, because a lot of complaints are arising at that particular point regarding the voltage sag and interruption. So for that, certain solution has to be designed. And you know, these are because they are affecting the commercial as well as the industrial customers, because small interruptions causes a lot of financial losses. So we see that they are virtually unnoticeable, but with the blinking of eyes, you know, just for you, it may just flicker. The light may have flickered when we look into that. But with that flickering only, it can stop the complete industrial process. So it can come to a halt point, you know. So we should be, the issue, when you look, may not look very seriously, but when it comes to an application point of view, it is really a very serious issue, fine, which needs to be tackled. So what we see that the possible effects of voltage sags would be system shutdown or reduce efficiency, and even the lifespan of the equipments will also come down like this, you know. So that's why we should take much more precautions to interrupt such kind of voltage sags. You know, some kind of protection devices should be there which can withstand this kind of sags or interruptions. So such disturbances are particularly problematic for industry because they are the major customers which gets affected by such kind of interruptions, and that may result into huge financial losses. So anything persisting, any sag which persists for more than 1 minute, we usually define them as an undervoltage. So it is very important to understand what is an undervoltage. You know, undervoltage, you can just say the voltage below, because whenever we ask that question, the first answer will be something below this particular percentage, below the nominal value is undervoltage. It's not more than the magnitude, it's about the duration, how long your voltage sag is persisting. So for that, if the sag is there for more than 1 minute, then you define it as under voltage. So then it is really a serious issues for such a big industry people or the customers. Fine, so what is the approaches of this particular voltage sag right through? So how do we go about it? So you can see in this particular figure, we will understand the whole concept with the help of this particular figure. So, you know, the level one, we have divided into four levels. So the protection can be applied at your level one, which is at the equipment specification. And then the level two, you come to a control protection. Level three, where you are talking about the overall protection inside the plant. And here, level four, you're talking about the utility solutions, right? So there are four levels. So now, as you see the arrow sign, which is shown over here, and it's very clearly indicated that the cost incurred at the level one definitely is much, much lesser than the cost you need to pay at the level four. So the cost also increases as your level increases. Fine. So it is much more, it has been seen while doing the test also, as I will show you in the case study also, that anything you do retrofitting in the devices, equipment itself, you can get a better SAG write-through. Fine. When I say a word retrofitting, what do I mean by that? A retrofitting means that you are adding a new technology on the existing system such that the system is able to withstand the voltage sag or an interruption for a particular period. You know, so that is what, if you do it, and if you, especially if you embedded them into the equipment itself, and every manufacturer provides such kind of write-through to the customers, you know, it will become very easier for the customers to do their initial evaluation. So that is the main reason that the system really going to be able to withstand such kind of voltage sags or interruptions if the equipment itself have that write-through capability. Fine. So if sometimes the equipment may be able to withstand, but there are certain controlling systems which force the equipment to shut down. So in that case, what do you need? You need a protection at the controlling system too. So then you require some condition monitoring or conditioning system, which can take care of these kind of issues in the control system. You know, so you require a control protection at the control level two order. So whether you talk about controls, you talk about the motors, you talk about the other loads. So basically you required some kind of conditioning system for various machine tools. Fine. Then we come to a third level. So when I talk about overall protection inside the plant, so how do I provide that protection? That means that is only possible. One of the way of doing that is your backup supplies. You know, so the backup supply will be in the form of your UPS. So you have a various type of UPS online, offline, or hybrid. So you can go for some sort of backup supply, which will help you to withstand this kind, give you a backup supply during the time of SAG. Fine. Similarly, then you come to the fourth one. Similarly, the fourth level solution, when I talk about a utility solution. So this utility solution has to give complete alternative solution for the utility system. Okay. So when you talk about something providing a protection scheme or some alternative scheme for the complete utility, definitely this will be more and more costlier. Fine. So we need to control or we need to design the system in such a way that my system is able to withstand the various types of voltage sags, or it is an under voltage, or it is an interruption at the beginning level itself. That means at the level one itself, even if it fails to do at level one, it should be able to do some kind of protection at level two. Fine. So we have to make our design which should sound economical as well as optimal. Fine. So with this, I just read out few of the lines. I think almost I have covered. So you can see that several things can be done by the utility, end user, and equipment. Means, you know, from the utility end, or from the facility end, or from the equipment manufacturer, all can help to reduce this number and the severity of these voltage sags, and reduce the sensitivity of the equipment towards this voltage sag. So it has to be from all the types. You have to think about from the utility end, from the facility end, and from the manufacturer. If everybody thinks about it, the number of voltage sags taking place or the severity of the voltage sags which are happening can be reduced. Fine. The next we see is that's, I told you about the figure, talks all about the capability, write through capability curve, and that also indicates that the how costly from the level one to level four. Fine. So the best answer is to incorporate them itself at the equipment level. This essentially means keeping problem equipment out of the plant. You know, you are you are just taking care of your valid voltage sag problem issue at the equipment level itself. So you are not coming to the plant. You are just keeping it in that particular point itself, level one itself. So, or at least identifying some sort of control protection, some kind of condition protection at the control point. You should be able to identify that much more ahead. You know, before that only you should have an idea, okay, here it's not working, let me think about at the level two. So all these designs and protection schemes should be thought up much more before the time. Ahead of the time, you should think about it. You know, you need to identify it immediately. You have to think about what is the alternative solutions which can be provided, because more time you waste on thinking process at the time of the fault or at the time of the sack or interruption, there will be a more financial losses from the big customer's end. Okay, so now what are the things which you should keep it in mind during the time of equipment procurement? So what is that which I've told you, that all the customers should demand, you know, first of all, the manufacturer should provide that right through capability curve to the customers. And if not, its customer should ask that particular curve from the manufacturer so that it will help them for initial evaluation. What is the second point we talk about? Second point we talk about, the companies which are procuring these kind of new equipment should have certain procedure, you know, that rates the importance of the equipment. You should have the rating of the which equipment is more critical, which is less. So you have a certain procedure which will take care of the rating of such kind of equipments. If the equipment is critical in nature, the company must make sure that the adequate right through capability is included when the equipment is purchased. So this is very, very important term when you talk about the right through capability. You know, that is very important, depend on the how the critical or how sensitive the equipment is. Third point which we are looking at, the equipment should at least be able to write through sags with a minimum voltage of 70% as per as ITI curve, which you can see the ITI curve I will show you, and I will explain. Last class also we have talked about it, but this lecture also we will be seeing about this particular curve, what is basically this curve all about. Fine. So these are the three major points which we should keep it in mind while procuring an equipment. I repeat, number one, that the manufacturer should provide a right through capability curve for each equipment. If not, the customer should demand that, such that the initial evaluation is possible from the customer end. Second thing, every customer should have certain procedure to rate the equipments. Fine. Third thing, equipment should be able to write through of a minimum sag of 70%. Now what happened at level three? Okay, at level three, what happened? You know, you require a certain sort of backup supplies. So these backup supplies can be in the form of a UPS for a shorter period of time. Level four requires, which I told you already, level four basically represents the alteration made of complete for the utility power system. Fine. So they are very, very costly, so that they can significantly reduce the number of sags and interruptions. Then we see, as certain solution at higher levels of available power, the solution become, as you go more higher level, the solution becomes more and more costlier. If the required write through cannot be provided at the specification stage, that means I'm talking about at the equipment stage, it may be possible to apply at UPS system or at the controlling system. Fine. So you can think about at the level two or level three. So this is applicable when the machines themselves can withstand the sag. Okay, what I've talked about in the previous point is that this kind of, whether you go for level two or level three, is possible only when the machines are able to withstand at level one, but forcefully they are shut down by the control system at level two. So that is what where you think about a protection scheme at level two or level three. So now what I was talking about, the ITIC curve. So basically first the CBEMA curve came at 1970, and that is basically developed keeping the mainframe computers in mind. So CBEMA is nothing but Computer Business Equipment Manufacturer Associations. So they have come out with these curves which will help in finding out the capability of the equipments to withstand certain withstand these voltage sags and interruptions. Fine. Then later on came the modified version of the CBMA CAVE in 1994, that is your ITIC, Fine. So these ITIC curves are again revised at 2000. And the difference between these ITIC curves and CBMA curves are nothing, but they just give you much more expanded area or operating region for the equipments to show their write through capability. You know, so these ITIC curves are nothing but the Information Technology Industry Council as a full form. So these curves are basically used to study, these ITIC curves are basically used to study for the 120 volt and 60 hertz computers and their peripherals. But now recently they are used almost for all type of equipments. Okay, so these are used as a reference to define the withstand curve. Just now I told you, these curves are used to define the withstand capability of the various loads and devices for protection from power quality problems. So this ITIC is better than CVMA in order to saying that they have more expandable area and operating region. Moreover, the instrumentation to check the compliance with the curve appears is much more design, much more easier to design because it is a simple way you get an acceptable region, whether the system is working or not working. So when you look at the region, you can say if the system is going to trip or not. So this gives a very clear cut picture how the equipment is going to behave under sag or interruption. Now we come to a case study. So before we jump into the case study, let us see typical situations which we find from the end user. That is the typical end user equipment sensitive to voltage sags are. What are the basic problems which end user face? That is your computers, your PLCs, your control power supplies, motor starter contactors, contact relays, and ASDs. So these are the major components of the equipments which are very sensitive towards your voltage sags. So we need to take care of these components from that end, okay? So a very important distinction must be made applying. And so what happens? So these throughout your system, loads of various range. You have a lower load, you have a medium load, you have a high load. For all the loads, your protection scheme cannot be similar. Your mitigation cannot be same. So there is a different solution for different region of loads. So some of the loads are standalone, some are standalone and controls, they're completely take care of them. They have complete their own control. So in that case, the start and stop without causing any damage to the motor, the driving equipment, a process or a personnel. So what we are trying to say that some of the above loads, what we have discussed in the point number one, they are standalone devices or control single standalone motors that can start and stop without causing any damage. So they can start and stop. So you need not to put a separate protection scheme for that. So you must be careful from where, for which particular equipment you want to put the protection scheme. Fine. So in the case of motor starter contactors, it is necessary to understand whether the load or the process involved before retrofitting any change in the protection. That is what exactly I told you in the previous point. Understand the equipment or the machine you are dealing with. You are putting an any extra new technology as a protection scheme to the existing equipment. You should know about the load or its process. Fine. Then only because unnecessary if you add and retrofitting to the system, it may cause a damage to the process or to the operator. So what happens in the case of most of the motors on pumps, for an example, like most of your HVAC system or your small pumps or your any small such kind of devices will have their automatic restart. So they can automatically restart once they face any kind of sags or interruption. But when you talk about a huge system like a chiller system, there you need a control process. You cannot just leave it for an automatic process. It needs a complete control process to restart. Fine. So with that small example, what we have learned, because we are going for a case study. So this case study, before we jump into the case study, we have understood that the scheme of protection should be applied by looking into the machine, the process, the operating procedure, and then we should do it because unnecessary protective system may cause damage to the machine itself, fine? So now what happens in this particular case study, an EPRI, it's around at 2000, they have published certain 30 documents done by EPRI Power Products Application Center, and they have performed this test on around 30 semiconductor fabrication tools. And what they have found? They found that this study indicates that retrofitting done on the small equipment itself will show a remarkable increase in your voltage sag capability. SAG write through capability, you know. So the retrofitting in the very small equipment stage only, if you do it, the you will find a remarkable increase in SAG write through capability of the equipment. Okay, so in that test, they have found the most sensitive device, which is emergency off relay. Then they found about the next sensitive was contactor, and third they have found out PLCs and some DC logic system. Fine. So based on the test, they have defined which equipment is more sensitive towards the SAG and all, and which requires more, the retrofitting into the equipment itself. So the test identified two approaches to extend this voltage SAG right through. That is based on the expense. So you have something called as a least expense and to the more expense. So the least expensive approach is for the manufacturer to embed it the write through system itself in the machine, which I told you. So the best part, it will be more less expensive to you if you do this retrofitting at the small equipment and you embedded them into the small equipment itself. And the more expensive is to provide some form of selective power conditioning system. So when you go to the next level, and you provide some other type of conditioning system, then it's really more expensive than the previous one. A very simple solution found was to make sure that all the machines or tools operate at rated voltage. So because if your any tools or machines are running less than the rated voltage, they are more prone to the, they're more sensitive to this voltage sag. So that is also been found in this particular test, that anything is not any power supply relay contactor are supplied with less than the required rated voltage, they are, that particular unit will be more sensitive towards the voltage sags. So it is very important to pay close attention to the, now what do I do it? So it's when I take a question of supplying a rated voltage. So how do I do that? So that means you required a constant monitoring of the tap of the transformers. So tap changing of the transformers need to be constant monitored. Fine, so that will help you, because we have seen in that the test has also been proved that if you constant monitoring the tap changing of the transformer has shown a lot of improvement in write through. Fine, so another very simple solution was found that phase to phase voltages for controls instead of going for phase to neutral. So you try to go for phase-to-phase voltage for controls instead of going for phase-to-neutral. Then some manufacturers also recommended that the use of phase monitoring relay. So you use a phase monitoring relay, which will help you to understand the phase rotation, voltage change in the voltage magnitudes and the unbalance into the system. Plus also it will also give you certain data like the trip is happening, but without any reason behind it. You know, simply the system is getting tripped, but the system is not undergone any sort of sag or interruption. So that kind of data also can be captured with the help of phase monitoring relay. Fine. So these are the certain things which have been found out through this type of test done by EPRI. So quite important test these were, and this gives a clear picture that whatever we have studied in approach towards the voltage sag write through capability is true. Now this can be counterproductive if the result is nuisance tripping. That is what exactly I told you. Now what are the solutions at the end user level? I saw that there are the, these are the possibilities. I should do something at the equipment level. I should do something at the level 2 condition control system. So basically, what are these solutions? So these solutions based on the type of loads are connected. You know, I told you that loads can be divided into, low loads, medium, the capacity of the loads is less, it's medium, it's pretty large. So based on that, you think about your solutions. So what do we see? Solutions to improve the reliability and the performance of the process or facility can be applied to many different levels. So the different technologies available should be evaluated. So before you implement them, first evaluate them based on the specific requirement of your process. The solutions can be discussed. We have categorized these different cases. The first is protection for smaller loads. So when I'm talking about smaller loads, that means I'm talking about less than 5 kV. It's not necessary that every scheme has to think about as a less than 5 kV. This can be changed based on system to system. Fine. So this usually involves protection for equipment controls for small or individual machines. Many times these are single phase loads that need to be protected. So we are talking about a very, very small loads or a single phase loads in this particular section. Section two takes care about an individual equipment which is of around 300 kV or roughly around 400 to 500 kV, or a group of equipments which is giving you up to that much of load. Fine. So these kind of equipments usually require a power conditioning technologies. So this usually represents applying a power because you are going for a plus or medium load, you know. So there you require a power conditioning technologies within the facility for protection for critical equipments that can be grouped together conventionally. So you need to take care of the critical equipments first. Since usually not all loads, yes, very important, all loads in the facility not required that they need a protection, okay? So for this can be, so you have to find an economical solution for such kind of problem. So you please deal with first the critical loads and then you can take care of the rest of the loads. So this particular point talks about it. Since usually not all the loads in a facility need protection, this can be a very economical method of dealing with critical loads first, especially if the need for protection of these loads is addressed by the facility design stage, fine? So first you take care of the critical loads, then you give preference to the rest of the loads. Number three, I'm talking about a large group of loads, okay? Or I'm talking about a complete low voltage. I'm talking about a large group of loads, but at a low voltage level. So here, sometimes a such large portion of facility is critical or needs protection that is reasonable to consider protection under a large group. You know, usually you required a somewhat of kind of a backup supply in this kind of system. So new technologies are available for consideration when large group of loads need protection. So I will talk about this. What are these technologies we are talking about? A completely new technologies which are added into the system to provide the protection for such kind of loads. Fourth number of protection, I'm talking about a load, huge load, but at a medium voltage, or I'm talking about at the supply system. Fine. So these kind of loads needs protection or improved power quality solution at the medium voltage level can be considered. So these are also having a separate newer technology which are available. So we will discuss in the next slides. As I told you, the sizes, whatever I have mentioned over here, 5 kVA or 300 kVA, it will change. These are all or are just taken a value just to make you understand. So these will depend on various technologies. Okay, so what are these technologies? When we are talking about the new kind of technologies are added into the system for the protection scheme, so the system can withstand through the sag and interruption. So what are these? Let us see the first one. First one is a ferro-resonant transformers, okay? So these are, as you can see, it is mentioned over here. What is this written over here? Constant voltage transformer, or in a short form, we call them as CVTs. So these constant voltage transformers are nothing but they are used for constant and low power loads, fine? So please keep it in mind. They are mainly used for single phase purpose. So they are used for constant load, and second thing, low power loads. They are basically 1:1 transformers, okay? Since they have a tuning circuit at the output, that's why variable load does not give you a proper results. Next, we see a magnetic synthesizer. So these kind of magnetic synthesizers are, their operating principle is same as CVTs, but they are mainly used for three-phase devices. You know, they are talking about, you are going to, they give you improved voltage sag capability, and a regulation, voltage regulation for three-phase loads. So they are very good. They are basically for, you know, for the process control of large computers where this kind of issues are very, very serious. So that is where exactly magnetic synthesizers are used. Third comes the active series compensators. So active series compensators, these are, as the name says, the things that series means they are active means they're all the time, they are present in the system. Series, they are connected in series with your line. Compensate, they are compensating something. The question comes, what they're compensating? They're compensating the voltage. So as you can see in this figure, there is a fault at the parallel feeder and the voltage dips at the parallel line. So parallel feeder here, you can see there is a fault at one of the feeder and the parallel feeder gets affected. So you will find the dip in the voltage. So you can see that observed dip in the voltage over here. So this dip in the voltage will be compensated by your series compensator. So this series compensator, which I have used over here, is nothing but DVR. Okay. So they are, these are the dynamic voltage restorers. So this DVR is going to inject this extra voltage, which will help to restore the voltage of the system. So you can see that extra voltage, which is need to compensate this voltage sag, and the system comes back to its original voltage. That's how the active series compensator works. Then we see certain backup supplies, which we talk about UPS. So I have a UPS of three types: online UPS, standby UPS, and hybrid UPS. Okay. So what happens in case of an online UPS? As the name says, the loads are supplied through this UPS. So they are connected in line. Fine. So these particular UPS, they convert the AC to DC and DC back to AC. So this DC supply will be help them to charge the batteries. So in order, if there is any kind of problems at the input end, this load will be continuously supplied through this battery store, this energy stored in the battery for a particular duration. And when I come to a standby UPS also have a same function, only it is an offline. It's not an online, it is an offline. The problem with the online UPS is, you know, they cause a losses. They also include the losses into the system. So that's why sometimes it's not required. There are many loads which does not require this kind of, you know, protection scheme. So we need to be careful where we are using this online UPS. So we are much aware about offline UPS also. So the function of the offline UPS is also same, that they are used whenever there is a backup supply is needed. Hybrid UPS, what happens in this case of standby UPS, this standby UPS will not have any control for your transient taking place into the system or voltage regulation. This will not take, you know, they will not compensate for all those things. But whereas in hybrid, I'm going to add a voltage regulator, which will help to improve the write through capability. Then another technology is what we see is motor generator sets. So what happens in the motor generator? This is, you know, most basic type of and quite popular type of configuration. But this obviously the negativity is that they include losses into the system and the noise which comes out of these motors and generators. So actually input will be your motor will get powered through the line and that will drive your generator. And between you have a flywheel on the shaft. So this flywheel will help you to increase the write through capability. Whenever the inertia goes down, it will help to attain that particular value for a short duration. Fine. Similarly, we have another thing called as a flywheel energy storage systems and superconductive magnetic storage system, SMES. So these are basically the storage systems which help you to store your energy for a much more longer period, and they are much more faster compared to your battery storage. And also, especially when we see in case of an SMES, they are pretty fast in connecting the, you know, backup supply to the, when your primary supply goes off, connecting to the backup supply, they just do it in few seconds. So they're pretty faster in two electrical cycle, I think. So they just connected into the system. So they are pretty fast compared to the battery. And another benefit compared to the battery is that their charging and discharging are unlimited. Fine. So they are much, much better than your battery system. Then we come to a static and fast transfer switches. You know, so they are basically a conventional breakers and the static transfer switches. So they will help in disconnecting or connecting the healthier part from the unhealthy part. So you can use a vacuum fast breakers. These fast transfer switches are nothing but your vacuum breakers. They will just connect the system within a few seconds. So they are very fast in doing so. Especially this is required for critical loads. You know, where the load is very critical and the load cannot compromise for any power shutdown or voltage sag. So their fast transfer switches are used. Okay, with this we come to another interesting part of our lecture, that is quiz. And I hope all of you are happy to see the quiz. The best solution for voltage sag is, yes, my dear friends, we have already gone through the slides, and I hope by now you are very much clear about what is the best solution for voltage sag. What is that? To incorporate the write through capability into the equipment specification itself. Okay, so itself in the equipment at the level one itself, you embedded this particular write through capability. It is generally less costly to tackle the problem at its, you know, initial level. That means you talk it about as an initial level, or you talk about at the load level. So both means same. So here we talk about initial, lowest, or the load level. So it will be much less price. So the solution generally becomes more costly at the higher levels. Equipment should at least be able to write through voltage sags with a minimum voltage of -%. Yes, very good. It should be at least, they should, because you know that was a third point in our equipment procurement. Whenever you procure any equipment, you should keep three things in your mind. That is 70%, right? Okay, with this I end my today's lecture. I hope you have enjoyed and you have understood some basic concepts of fundamental of protection schemes. Fine, please take care. Bye.